The greatest happiness is not to feel the need for happiness. William Saroyan. At the writers' union, he asked, "Do you have insane people here?" The writers wonder what to say and who should give an answer. Silva Kaputikyan, who was one of the present, said, "Yes, and we built houses for them." Saroyan answered, "That's not what I'm asking. Do you have insane people here? In front of the White House, everyone is insane. When I get out of the plane, I always go up to them and talk with them. It's very interesting." He wakes up, then later the children will come and touch him, and it will start to come to life. This is the conifer tree from Bitlis, which he brought and grew in his California.
Absolutely. And what he was trying to do was be a great influence to the whole world, to stop this organized nonsense and realize that individuals make the difference.
The head told him that Mr. Kochinian wanted to receive him the same day, and he said, "Who is that?" They told him that Mr. Kochinian was the number one person in Armenia at that time. "Ah," he answered, "I have nothing to say to him."
He was always standing there, typing away, writing. And until he became famous, my aunt used to say, "I wish that you had been a shoemaker, you would have been more successful." Then when he hit the big time, became known, Im Vilis, you know, he became very famous to her.
And then he said, "Okay, now get away from the window." So I got away from the window. He went over to the window and he peeked out at the little boy, and I was watching through another window, and the little boy ducked down. So then Uncle Bill waited till the little boy peeked up, and then he ducked back. And they did this for like, I don't know, 10 minutes. They basically played peekaboo. And it just struck me as really odd. I said, "What are you doing?" And he said, we're having fun.
We stayed 6 days, maybe seven, now I don't remember, in Beirut. And during these days, we became very close. When I say we became close, he knew every Armenian in the world, and they knew him, they knew each other.
One lonely immigrant boy,
on his way home from work one day,
going from work one day,
saw a beautiful girl,
see fine U.S. number one girlie,
and fell in love with her.
Fall in love with her right away.
He looked at her and she looked at him.
He looked on her, she looked on him.
He wanted to tell her wonderful things,
but he didn't know just what to say.
He loved her and he wanted to marry her.
He loved her, he wanted for to marry her.
So he told her ordinary things in a wonderful way.
So he told her in old country way. Come on to my house, my high house, I'm gonna give you candy. Come on to my house, my high house, I'm gonna give you apple, a plum, and apricot to do. Come on to my house, come on.
Come on. Come on.
My father died when I wasn't even 3 years old. Armenak Saroyan was 36 years old when he died. My brother Henry and sisters, Zabel and Cosette, we went to an Armenian orphanage, where we stayed 5 years. When I was 8 years old, we left Oakland, California and returned to Fresno. Before I was born, my brother Henry and sisters, Zabel and Cosette, were born in Bitlis. I was born there, in Fresno, California. When we returned to the family, which lived in Fresno, California, I didn't know one word of Armenian. I learned in 2 weeks, and what I learned then, I speak now. I didn't go to an Armenian school, and I don't know how to read and write. Therefore, we can say that I learned in our family school. William Saroyan. Many times in the past, he was remembered, and it's remembered now, and God knows how many dozens of times his life and literary works will be reflected on, even if instigated by feelings of gratitude and humility. Isn't it true that long ago his name was written in the glorious books of universally great people? What Armenian would miss the opportunity as an individual to feel proud to be a member of the same nationality of the renowned author? They would say in America, where he was born and became famous, that he created himself. But in Hollywood, or in the theaters of Broadway, which formed an inseparable part of his fate, when talking about a similar hero of the stage, it would definitely be said that it was here he stood on his own feet. Many insist that on the stage of life, he acted as if he were on the stage in the theater. But in that play which he wrote, directed and played the main role, many considered him not to be acting, that this was his real life, and that he showed the real life of the 20th century as an irrefutable element of universal civilization.
Two families without fathers, having to go out and look for work, walking through alleyways all the time, you felt displaced. You didn't belong anywhere. So you had to crawl through life, which we did.
Here's Archie, who was basically his best friend and his first cousin. Besides being his first cousin, they were best friends. These are Archie's daughters Archie Manassian's daughters playing in the snow somewhere in the mountains of California. And I can say this about the girls. He loved his relatives, he loved his painting, his poetry, but his daughters were, that was his life. It was, you know, he was a family person number one.
Yeah, well, we used to have events in the patio all the time where everybody, you guys would come.
Absolutely.
All the family would come and Willie would come and we'd all just laugh and have fun. And our impression was, you know, he's just part of the family. He's just a regular person. He just was a fun person. My father and he would always just get together and they would go to the racetrack, or they would go to Reno and go gambling, or they would go out in the desert and just tour around, or they would go to Fresno. So it was like he was just part of the family. He wasn't somebody famous. We knew he was famous, but
this is the famous or well-known Uncle Aram. And this is the person that my name is Aram is modeled after. He was the patriarch of the family, someone I can say everybody looked up to. Obviously, he's not a shy person. His Araman hand gestures are imitated to this day by all of the relatives and others too.
Uncle Aram was everybody's uncle, including Willie's uncle. Archie's uncle, Stell's uncle, and our great-uncle. General Antronig ends up going to Aram's office to meet with Uncle Aram, because Aram was the man to see in Fresno. And Willie happened to be at that meeting and recorded the event in one of his short stories.
In his first collection of short stories, My Name is Aram, there's a story that Willie writes about the pomegranate tree.
Yes.
And this is a classic story, and if you read it carefully, you find a tremendous amount of humor in that story. Well, after I read it, I called my mother's sister, Helen, and I said, Auntie, this sounds like a story about Uncle Aram. And she says, Darling, let me tell you the whole story. Uncle bought some land, and they planted pomegranate trees. And it was fertile land, so the trees didn't grow very well. There was no natural water there. But after the first picking, they decided to ship the crop to Chicago. But nobody in Chicago knew what pomegranates were. So the crop was rejected and returned. But of course, Uncle made a claim for the insurance because he insured the claim before they shipped. And everything turned out just fine. But that's the story about the pomegranate tree. And it was unbelievable.
That's cute.
And the famous story that is recounted, because this was actually told in the presence of General Antronig, was, what is this young man doing? And Willie identifies himself as a writer, even in those days. I'm a writer. And his Uncle Aram says, well, I'm a writer. I write checks. What do you write? One of the things that's so important about the family history is that the family history is recorded in Willie's stories, so that family members can simply read one of Willie's stories and you know instantly who the figure is, although the name has changed.
When I turned 20, 21 years old, I went to New York. My family understood I wanted to become a writer, and that news reached Neshan Papazian, a barber. I needed a haircut, but I didn't have enough money. He called me and said, sit down. I said, I have no money. He said, sit down. So I sat down. He quietly but very badly cut my hair and said, you are a great writer. I said, how is that you say something like that, Papazian? You say this very seriously. He said, I have heard. I returned to San Francisco, passed by Nishan Papazian's shop, and this time I went in because this time I had money. I sat down and again he cut my hair and said, you have published 2 books, word has reached us. As I said, now I have a question for you. You write and write, but do you remember what you write about? I said, no, I forget immediately. Aha, he said, I know it must be like this. If not, you shouldn't continue to write. I said, exactly, right. I was amazed at the man's knowledge, this modest, good Armenian man. But I was especially amazed when he said to me, young man, you are a great writer. I looked for a long time, saw everything and understood. After that I thought, fine, but what after this? What shall we do? William Saroyan. What was Saroyan like in the company of those close to him, when it wasn't necessary to solve the eternal problem well-known people have of being oneself or appearing as something you're not? And if one is being himself, what's the limit of openness? And if you're playing being something you're not, how can you do this so as not to harm your image as a creative, crazy being?
He loved coming to our house because he always liked the family atmosphere that he didn't really have. So he always told our father that he always had what he wanted, a nice family, you know, a loving wife. My mother, he just adored. And he was just part of our family. It was happy times. You know, we were always laughing and happy and did everything together. And the only person that my father would ever go off with was him. They, you know, he was always home with the family, and he'd take little trips, overnight trips to Reno or Tahoe, or go to the racetracks. Sometimes we got to go with them. But it was just a normal part of our life, you know.
I knew different things about his will, and I asked him, "What will you do? What will you leave to Lucina and Aram?" In other words, to his son and daughter. "Dikran, all of that is fine. The false thing they're saying, I left very good things to each of them. It's written there that they will receive $150,000 when I die. It's enough money." "Ha," I said, "are there any conditions?" "No, but there is one small condition, that when Aram's youngest child, which is son and is named Armenak, my father's name, when he turns 30 years old, that money will be his." How old is Armenak now? 5 years old.
"Come on to my house, my high house, I'm gonna give you candy. Come on to my house, my high house, I'm gonna give you apple, a plum, and apricot to add. Come on to my house, my house, come on. Come on to my house, my house, come on. Come on to my..."
I remember towards the end when Willie was in the hospital in Fresno and he was on his deathbed. It was Uncle Archie who actually tried to get Willie's children, both Lucy and little Aram, into the hospital to see Bill,
yeah,
to make peace. There had never really been any animosity from Bill to the children, but Bill felt that the children basically had let him down and had sided with the mother through the divorces and had taken the mother's side on the family history rather than his, and they didn't understand him. And it was Archie who brought Lucy to the hospital, who did ultimately tell her father, who she called Pop, "Pop, mm-hmm, I love you." And I don't know exactly what happened with little Aram, but I know they tried to make up at the end as well. But it was as a result of Uncle Archie Khachik being there with him to make sure that he didn't leave without them knowing how he felt about them.
"And the pomegranate too. Come on to my house all of your life. Come on, come on, come on, come on, and be my wife."
Years later, when we found out Uncle Bill was sick, on Easter weekend, before he went into the hospital, I drove up with Jason on the way to visit my dad in San Francisco, and I stopped to go in, and I walked in the house, and the house was a disaster. The living room was a mess, the bathroom was a mess, the papers were strewn everywhere, and Uncle Bill didn't look so great either. He was sitting on his bed, surrounded by papers and things that he'd been, as he said it, "I guess I'm doing the George Bernard Shaw version of dying." And I said, "Well, that's interesting. Do you need anything?" And we talked and shared some conversation, and he signed a bunch of books that he had had me bring that were his, that he wanted me to have signed versions of. And he said, "Just promise me you'll never sell them. You can give them to friends, but don't sell these." And I said, "I would never sell them." And then he said, and you have to understand, he hadn't shaven in 3 days, his hair was a mess. He said, "Can I see Jason?" And I looked around at the house and I thought, well, my son's 9 and this might be the last time he sees Uncle Bill. And I said, "Actually, no." And he said, "Why?" And I said, "Because he loves you and I don't want this to be what he remembers of you. This is a pretty Dickensian motif here and I just think that's not good." And he looked at me and he said, Well, then you must be some pretty goddamn good father to tell me no, huh? And I said, I don't know, I think it's wrong, Uncle Bill. And he said, I totally understand. So we hugged, and I drove up to visit my dad, and Jason did not go in. And the weekend went by, and on Easter Sunday, the phone rang, and this story always makes me pretty emotional. My dad got off the phone, and he said, well, that was Bill, and he wants you to stop by on the way home when you're driving back to L.A., which, of course, is a longer way to get home than Highway 5. So we did, and I stopped in front of the house, did the same thing as before, and I opened the door. Now, this is a man that was 3 weeks from dying, roughly. I opened the door, and it looked like the Marriott Suites. The entire house had been cleaned. All the papers were put away. There was no sign of anything wrong. I turned and looked down the hallway. It was pristine. The bathroom was all clean. I look in the bedroom, and Uncle Bill is sitting there just buttoning up his pajamas, his last thing, and then he slicked his hair back, and he put on his little babushka hat, and he looked up and he said, now can I see Jason? And I said, yeah. I went and got him, and they had this lovely visit together, which my son remembers to this day.
I love life. I'm resigned to death. William Saroyan.
It's incredible seeing how he left the scene. What courage it took. Laying there in the hospital, he says, here I am, Arch, dying like a dog. It's a funny thing. I got up 2:30 in the morning, on the morning that he passed away, and wrote a little poem for him. The birds are in his trees, feeding on the early morning peach and plum. Soon they will be off in the morning sky, and he will be with them. And do you know that 3 hours later, his boy called me and says, Pop passed away. Isn't that strange?
When Uncle Willie passed away, it was 5 years later my father passed away, but part of my father died also. I noticed a big difference in him. His spirit wasn't the same. He just really, really missed him, and it was sad to see. But I remember that, and 5 years later, my father got sick and passed away after that. But I remember what a big difference his whole being was after that.
It was tragic. He had lost his spirit.
Yeah.
He had lost his spirit.
This stone, William Saroyan, when I was working on the statue, his hand was resting here. It was the last day, I thought. How should I say this? That I saw William Saroyan. I went to see him, but they wouldn't let anybody in. The son came, but he wasn't let in. Only the doctor was there. I shouted, how is it to you you won't let me see him? He is my friend. I wanted to see Willie one more time. He was dying. Then he shouted, let Varas come in. I said, Willie, what is this? How are you? He said, Varas, I'm not well. I'm dying. I don't want to live. Then he turned his head, didn't say anything else, and closed his eyes. I looked and then came out. Later they came, took him, cremated him. Half they took to Armenia, and half was left here.
I had a strong sense of death at the outset, partly because it was brought home to me before I was 3 years old that my father was dead. Now, that impermanence impelled me to think along the lines of how could I outwit death itself, the inevitable, and consequently the apparent meaninglessness of having been born. And it seemed to me that lasting things was the way to do it. I chose writing. I made the decision very early, long before I was 10 years old.
William Saroyan. His earliest and most vivid memories are connected to Fresno. During the course of his life, in New York, Paris, and London, he always remembered his birthplace. And these memories didn't fade with time, but continued to influence with the same fervor. He loved his city, and never missed the opportunity to acknowledge Fresno. It was there that, at the age of 10, he began selling newspapers and was considered the fastest and most energetic in his work. After that, he worked in a telegraph office. By the time he had reached 18, he had worked at nearly every kind of job available, including as a laborer in the grape vineyards and farms of the San Joaquin Valley. A short time later, he had already reached San Francisco, where he managed a telegraph office. Those years, at the beginning of 1920s, he bought his first typewriter for the price of $15. Saroyan told his relatives that the typewriter was necessary for his job at the telegraph office. But in reality, the 14-year-old Saroyan had already chosen his profession and began to write the human story of his beloved city and its inhabitants. He described the streets of Fresno and the telegraph office, which he swiftly passed on his bicycle. The same bicycle that he rode past the red brick Armenian church and courthouse garden. And without doubt, he wrote about these people that walked these streets, drank beer, sold newspapers, worked for their daily bread, fell in love and were disappointed, confronted difficult realities, and believed that life would continue and was wonderful and miraculous. One often comes across the name of Saroyan in today's Fresno. This is the acknowledgement of mutual love and gratitude of the city and its esteemed citizen. Beginning of 1940s, film studio Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer's president and owner Louis Mayer offered his old friend William Saroyan to write a film script. They decided to first write the script, then Saroyan would shoot a short film, after which a larger project would be realized. When they were reading aloud the finished script to Louis Mayer, he became overcome with emotion and started to cry. In just 4 days, Saroyan wrote and directed his first and what turned out to be his last film. The author's altered short story became the foundation of the 10-minute film. With the title of Good Work, the short film became the first time an Armenian word was heard in a Hollywood film. That part was written specially by Saroyan.
How much?
15 cents a dozen.
How much the whole box?
35 cents.
Dos kasan karasun hing spanvan kakhbar spanvan hing hazar mgwani haro. Give me the whole box.
I
Go back. Go back.
Anem tu na gvor me ut. Yer kar jamara kechen kir.
Of course, Louis Mayer would hardly trust such a serious project to a newcomer director. Clarence Brown, one of the best and most experienced directors of the film studio, directed the human comedy. Saroyan was angered by such deception. He wanted to buy back his work, asking Mayer to increase the payment he had received for the script. Of course, he was refused. Exactly the same year, in the autumn of 1942, he wrote and directed the play Go Away, Old Man, on Broadway. The play reflected on the pain and rage of what happened to him. But most importantly, he rewrote the script and published the novel, The Human Comedy. The film's premiere and presentation of the book took place on the same days. For the film script, the author was awarded an Oscar by the American Film Academy.
He waved to the engineer, but the engineer did not wave back to him. He waved to five others who were with the train, but not one of them waved back. They might have done so, but they didn't. At last, a Negro appeared, leaning over the side of a gondola. Ulysses heard the man singing. Weep no more, my lady. Oh, weep no more today. We will sing one song for the old Kentucky home. For the old Kentucky home far away. Ulysses waved to the Negro, too, and then a wondrous and unexpected thing happened. This man, black and different from all the others, waved back to Ulysses, shouting, "Going home, boy! Going back where I belong!" The small boy and the Negro waved to one another until the train was almost out of sight.
Come on to my house, to my high house, I'm gonna give you candy.
And I can recall a evening in San Francisco, in our living room on 11th Avenue. William Saroyan, Ross Bagdasarian, the founder of the Chipmunks, who later became David Seville, and Archie, Kirk, Zav, the whole brigade were all in the living room. And it was after Ross had become famous with the Chipmunks. If you remember the first song, The Witch Doctor.
Ooh, ee,
ooh, ah, ah, ting, tang, walla, walla, bang, bang.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Well, he was autographing the records that night. And Willie and he were talking about their first collaboration where they wrote the song, Come On To My House. Willie did the words, Ross did the musical background.
I love your hair. Hey, come on to my house, come on. Come on to my house, come on. Come on to my house, I'm gonna give you Easter egg. Come on to my house, I'm gonna give you everything. A figs and the dates and the grapes and the cakes. Apple, a plum and apricot too. A peach and a pear, I love your hair. A marriage ring and a pomegranate too. Come on to my house all of your life. Come on, come on, come on, come on and be my wife.
When they say great man, the first image that appears before my eyes is Saroyan. He was always rich, full, with a deep, dense voice. So the most important meeting, a great meeting, in which we spent the entire evening together, was at the newly opened Ararat restaurant. They set a long table, and in the middle, just the opposite, they set up a comparatively smaller table. Back then we had no money, but we had to treat Saroyan. We knew that he loved cognac a lot, Armenian of course. So we ordered cognac and other things, then more, different kinds of delicacies. And all this was on his side of the table. On our side we had Hrazdan wine, because it was the cheapest, along with some very basic things to eat. He was interested in everything and asked everybody, "Who are you? What are your names? What do you do?"
Երկուսին գիշերվա մոտավորապես մեկ էլ ներս մտան.
At about 2 in the morning, Gurgen Janibekian and David Malian entered the restaurant. We were shocked and asked, "What are you doing here?" Then people from different organs, KGB, I don't know, from whichever central or regional communist committee, had become nervous and sent these men to watch over us, to make sure that Saroyan didn't ruin our beliefs or say anything anti-Soviet or like that. But that made us very sad, and in a way we were let down, deflated. Saroyan asked, "Who are these people?" We said that they were our actors, people's actors. "What does that mean, people's actors?" We said that they were very famous actors. He said, "Let them sit with us and have a good time." Janibekian was upset, as his night's sleep had been disturbed, and was muttering something under his breath, then said, "David, why don't you say something?" David Malian got up and said, "Welcome, Mr. Saroyan, to your country. We live very well here, and we have our political party. And if our party tells us, go and conquer virgin lands, we go and conquer virgin lands." Saroyan asked, "What does that mean?" If I had said what this really means, our party directs us, tells us, go to war, and we go to war. If the party has an idea, if it's born, we become soldiers for the idea. We are its soldiers. This is how David put it. Then Saroyan got up from where he was sitting, lifted his glass of cognac, walked some more, turned around, and then said, "You talk? I'll go to pee." And he left. Janibekian, joking, said, "Hey, what are we doing here? Let's go, David. Get up and let's go." And they left. They left and Saroyan wasn't around. For 1 minute, 5 minutes. Finally, they went to the bathroom. There he was, standing, drinking cognac and singing a song. We told him, "Mr. Saroyan, let's go." He asked, "Did those soldiers go?" We told him that they had left. And he exclaimed, "I'm coming. Let's go and continue our party." He came until morning, when the sun had already come up. We were still together. We went outside early in the morning. It was very sunny. Saroyan backed up against the wall, looked around and said, "This was fine. Now, shouldn't we find some prostitutes?" We said, "Mr. Saroyan, that we don't have."
I was the editor of our college literary magazine there. And in 1966, we were doing a series of events celebrating the lives of living authors or poets in America. When I mentioned the opportunity to Bill about coming to state and talking, he graciously accepted. English professor George Price do the introduction. And while he was still doing the introduction, I'm still waiting for Willie to come in, and I see this figure walking down. And I know it's Bill.
You saw it, you didn't hear it.
You could recognize Bill when he's walking.
And I'm motioning to him, and finally he comes down, and I said, you're late. He says, well, I hope they're waiting for me. I said, you won't believe the turnout today. The auditorium is packed. There's over 1,000 people in here. For 1 hour and 20 minutes, except for applause, he spoke to a mesmerized group of college students and professors about the art of writing and why he became a writer and what he expected from each of those in the audience to do if they shared his passion for life. But he used parallels from Mark Twain and John Steinbeck and all the American authors, and of course referred to Guy de Maupassant, the short story French writer, who was his envy. I mean, that's who he modeled many of his short stories after. But he had the crowd in absolute awe for 1 hour and 20 minutes. It was unbelievable. When it was finished, I was so proud, proud to have been there, proud to be able to say, that's my cousin.
Another time he called and said, dear Dikran, come here. Okay, fine, I said. Can we make an appointment so that your university's president, an attorney, come to my house? I want to tell them something. They came and he began to talk. He always loved to be on stage. Saroyan was, let's say, an actor. His entire life was an act. But that was normal. For him it was natural. And he said right away, President Hack, you see this box? Take it to your university. You see these books, these papers, these drawers, full of my writings. You see these beautiful paintings, which he painted? One day, all these can go to the university. And he said, now I will sign my will. And Dikran, you will sign it too. Then Leon Peters signed it, I also signed it, the attorney, and then Saroyan signed it. Of course, we read nothing, we just signed it. But I knew that there was one thing in that will which said, my papers, my writings, whatever I have, I want to confirm that it will be called the William Saroyan Foundation, which has already been in existence for 15 years. So we signed the will, talked, and he said, all of this has to be confirmed, but in the will the confirmation must read, all this has to be sent to Fresno State University, California State University, and California University in Berkeley. It is pointed out that two locations must have this department. Unfortunately, everything got mixed up, and nothing happened. My father would enter his studio, always with his Rolleiflex hanging from his neck, always ready. And one time, Martir Osarian suddenly pointed at my father and said, this is the great master. And at that moment, in the wink of an eye, he was captured and eternalized. And another very interesting incident from Saroyan's life. One day he's coming and sees a huge ship stopped there, with his typewriter in his hands, nothing else. He stands and says, I must take a trip with this ship. So the seaman student said, very good, give me your ticket and go and sit down. No, he said, I don't have a ticket, but I have to go on this ship. So he said, if you have to go, go and get a ticket. They put me in this place to take tickets and let people inside. The ship's captain came and showed him one or two large rooms. No, no, he said, I don't want this. I want a room without a window, and I want you to give me a lot of typewriter paper. Very well. So he went for a few months, a couple of months probably on the sea, and he didn't even come out of his room. Nothing. One day he comes out, looks around, the ship is stopped. And he said, I have to get off here. But do you know where we are? In the middle of the ocean, anchored right next to an island. so we can get some fresh water. A ship won't pass here for another 6 months. No, he said, this is exactly the place I want it to be. I'll get off here. He got off the ship and onto the island. And later, 6 months later, he came back. He then confessed something, saying, this has been the most fertile period of my life, because I wrote a lot, worthwhile, quality things. I wrote all this during this time. When I read his entire will, I saw that it was written that he didn't want to be buried. He wanted to be burned, cremated. I said, what is the problem? You're doing things backwards. You don't want to be buried under the soil? Dikran, under the soil or not, what is the difference? I have to go and not come back. That is the end, the conclusion. Of course, in that final time when dying, there is nothing. At that time, I'm indifferent. But what I don't want, is to have a grave and a stone and people that would come and say, this is the famous, well-known writer Saroyan. I don't want that. And I have said that when I die, 24 hours later, my body will be put on this spot and will be cremated. Okay, I said, that is how it will be. Fine. This is the end of the will. In the will I wrote that the ashes will be spread over Bitlis, the day that Bitlis is ours again. Of course, this didn't happen. In just a word, it was something amazing, something absurd. He died, they cremated him, and put his ashes in this bronze urn, which is here, at a place next to the cemetery, called Chapel of Light. And there, when you go inside, you see urns placed on the shelves. And you can look, and for 10, 15 years, when they come and look, they see Saroyan's urn. If you want to read, it says, William Saroyan. They look and they read. But a few months later, someone called me from San Francisco and said, Mr. Kuyumjan, if we ask you, will you take the ashes to Armenia? What ashes? You have no right to move the ashes. We must move them. Armenia wants this. We also want this. We will divide the ashes, get another urn, and send half the ashes to Armenia. We left. We reached Yerevan with the urn. But I was asking everyone, what shall we do with this? We have to go to the Komitas Pantheon. But what will happen in the Komitas Pantheon? There is something small there. And later, there will be a statue. How? Where will these ashes go? I said Saroyan's words. Don't let my friends put me under the soil. Don't let my grave be a regular one. We got there and saw that all of Yerevan was there. Hundreds of thousands of people, from villages, from everywhere. Demirjian and Petrosyan brought the tortured urn. When we got there and looked around, we saw a hole in the ground, a grave. I said to Cendian, Keshishan and Demir, who is an attorney, we can't do that. In other words, this was exactly opposite of the will. How can we put this under the ground? No, no, it must be this way. You will see that there is a concrete down below, and they will put it in the concrete. But the ashes were covered with soil. I said, Yahya Cendian, where is the priest, the Catholicos? They're not here. Only communists and, of course, all the intellectuals, right? Why did they put him under the soil? They didn't read his will, how he wanted things. No, no, Mr. Kuyumjan, everything is fine. Don't worry. Look at how happy the people are, etc., etc. I want and I wish to say farewell. and thank you, and peace, as well as friendship, what the whole world wishes to have, and silence, especially now, silence. With all my strength, I'm working for each person to return to his natural dignity and nobility. I want each person to be himself, to leave the crowd and return to his own body and soul. William Saroyan.
Smiled at the immigrant boy as if to say, tell me more. The boy did.
Come on to my house, my high house, I'm gonna give you a Christmas tree. Come on to my house, my high house, I'm gonna give you a marriage ring and a pomegranate to wear. Come on to my house, come on. Come on to my house, come on. Come on to my high house, I'm gonna give you a peach and a pear. I love your hair, hey. Come on to my house, come on. Come on to my house, come on. Come on to my high house, I'm gonna give you Easter egg. Come on to my high house, I'm gonna give you everything. The figs and the dates and the grapes and the cakes. Apple, a plum and apricot too. A peach and a pear, I love your hair. A marriage ring and a pomegranate too. Come on to my house all of your life. Come on, come on, come on, come on and be my wife.